this point, the Bible brings Jesus Christ into the argument. And it's a very significant point to do so. We sometimes forget, when we look at the life of Jesus and all that he accomplished, and of course our focus is on the cross, when he died for our sins, and when he rose from the dead on the third day. Often our focus goes back to the virgin birth, when God became a man, dwelt among us. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. We sometimes forget the life in between, when he lived a perfectly obedient life to the law of Moses. That is crucial. If it was just a matter of the sinless Son of God dying, and therefore he would be dying for our sins, well, why didn't Herod just kill him as a baby like those other babies? Wouldn't that have worked? Of course, that wouldn't work. He lived, he fulfilled the righteousness of the law. He lived in perfect, complete obedience. That's why he shows up right here, right after verse 12. The man who does them shall live by them. We say, none of us can keep the law. Well, there's one who did, and that's Jesus. And so the conclusion now is, Paul is taking a interpretive technique that the rabbis would use. And what they would do is, when they had two passages of scripture that were in close proximity to each other, as we're going to have here, and each passage shared a common significant term, they would look for an interpretive link, a connection. And that's what Paul does here. Earlier in verse 10, I told you he was quoting from Deuteronomy 27. Cursed is everyone who doesn't keep the whole law, right? Now, in verse 13, he's quoting from Deuteronomy 21, just a few chapters earlier. And what do we read there? Cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. And he makes a connection. And what is the connection? Well, again, let's look at verse 13. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. You see, we're the ones that are under the curse, because all of us recognize our sin in the eyes of God's law. None of us can ever keep God's law. So we're the ones who verse 10 is talking about. Cursed is everyone who does not continue in all things which are written in the book of the law. That's all of us. We're all cursed. Christ lived in perfect obedience to the law. He's not subject to that curse. But what he did was, he also became a curse for us. How? By sinning to the law? No. By being hung on a tree. Because cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. And there's the substitution that is made. I'm sure that when Paul first got saved, when the Holy Spirit indwelt his life, and it must have been an incredible time of just relearning all of those scriptures that he already knew. He's a scholar, a master of the scripture, and yet having to see everything in the Old Testament, all those prophecies, the teaching of the law, all of it with a new perspective, with the eye and the mind of Christ. And I'm sure one of the most troubling things before his salvation, and we don't have any details of, we know about Paul's persecution of the early church, but we don't necessarily have any record of some of the arguments he probably got into with guys, and he really, no doubt, had his share of passionate encounters. It probably drove him crazy, and that's why he said, we're just going to kill him and shut him up. But the thing that would have bothered Paul tremendously, and in fact still bothers a Jew today, how can Jesus of Nazareth possibly be the Messiah when he died on a tree? Cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. Now, Paul leaves out a little detail when he quotes that verse. If you go back to Deuteronomy 21, you'll read that it says, cursed of God is everyone who hangs on a tree. Paul left that out, didn't he? He didn't throw the of God in there. Because he's not about to say that Jesus Christ is cursed of God. But that's what would have bothered him. How can the Messiah be killed on a tree? I mean, if he's going to be a martyr, let him be run through with a sword or something. But he can't die that way. Cursed of God is anyone who hangs on a tree. Now, the context that that was given in the law was well before crucifixion. Don't think that that was a reference to crucifixion in the law of Moses. It was about a situation when someone justly deserved to die, and you put them to death, and you would hang their body for public display. And God says, all right, you can do that, but take it down before sundown, because this person is cursed to God, and you don't want to defile the land by leaving them up there. If you're looking for an example in the scripture of that, Joshua chapter 10. He kills these five kings of the Amorites, hangs up their bodies, and then makes sure they get taken down before sunset. So here we have the Messiah, according to these Christians at least, and he was hung on a tree. This is impossible. How does this work? And no doubt, once Paul got saved, and once the Holy Spirit began to teach him the scriptures and brought this connection to it, Paul realized how it works, why it's totally appropriate. One word: resurrection. The resurrection is the proof that God did not see Jesus cursed, even though, yes, he was hung on the tree. He was crucified. You say, Steve, come on, where's resurrection in these verses? Well, remember, we're breaking it up into little chunks every week. Turn a page, go back to the very first verse of this book. Paul, an apostle, not from men nor through man, but through Jesus Christ and God the Father, who raised him from the dead. It's the very first point Paul makes in the entire letter. And truly, Christianity is established on the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And do you notice that it is God the Father who in Scripture is given credit for raising Jesus from the dead? See, Jesus became a curse for us, hung on that accursed tree, and the Father brought him back to life, exalted him, gave him a name above every name. And the purpose of it all, verse 14, bringing again the two points together, that the blessing of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles. Again, in thee all nations will be blessed, because Jesus was Abraham's descendant. And all nations, Gentiles, blessed because of Christ, and that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Again, the moment you're declared righteous by God, justified, is the moment you receive the Holy Spirit. And all that happens is an act of faith. What an argument by Paul. Is this the relationship that you have with God? Do you see this in your own life? A relationship based on faith, not law. Just a relationship in the Spirit, not according to a do and don't list. I hope so.